Good morning, everyone. I would like to wish you a very good morning, and the people that were brave enough to join us in person, welcome, and the people that are watching virtually, welcome to our worship service. This is the first Sunday of Lent, so an important time of year for sure. The other thing I'd like to remind you of is that we're observing communion this morning, so if you're worshiping at home virtually, have your elements ready, and I hope everybody that came in this morning got their prepackaged kits at the door. Just a couple of announcements this morning. One that I want to point out is that it's daylight saving time next week. So if everybody will remember to adjust their clock so that you'll be able to join us at the appropriate time, that would be great. And I hope you had the opportunity to watch the slides and get the announcements on the screen here. The other thing that I'd like to mention is that you can always go on our website to look at the announcements and the events that are taking place. So please remember to do that. And our mission of the month this morning is Hellenic Ministries, and I believe Craig has a video to show us.
Our family serving in Athens, Greece. Here's an update on what we've been involved with in the past year. During the last few months, Javada stepped into a full-time pastoral role in a growing Farsi-speaking fellowship with Afghan and Iranian refugees. He works with a team of Canadian and American missionaries in the center of Athens, doing evangelism and discipleship. We've been so encouraged to see many refugees coming to Christ in the last few months, and even whole families being baptized. Please pray for us as we disciple new believers and help them in practical ways too. We've also started leading a marriage course for couples, and once a week Emily's involved in a young women's Farsi-speaking Bible study. In December at the Good Samaritan Social Medical Center, Javad and the team prepared Christmas programs for Arabic and Farsi-speaking women and children. They shared the gospel message, distributed hot meals, and gave food bags and gifts to the children. We've also been traveling north to visit refugee camps, take food, clothing, and other supplies, and meet with groups of believers and encourage them. We were moved to tears during our last trip while at a refugee camp. We met Luke, an Afghan believer who has been witnessing to people inside the camp, and many have come to Christ. As we entered the container where they were meeting, we began worshiping the Lord together. It is a scene that will be forever imprinted in our minds and on our hearts. God is at work and drawing people to Himself, and it is such an honor to be part of it. Operation Joshua took place again this summer. Over 40,000 New Testaments were delivered from door to door to every home in hundreds of villages across three prefectures. We had over 200 participants, which was a pleasant surprise. It's exciting to see our children involved in this work as they get older. Pray for the impact of God's Word through this project. Powerful testimonies are always a valuable tool in reaching people. That's why each year we publish a new testimony in tract form and include it in the pack we hand out. I design these and other tracts that are included. Teams help pack the New Testaments and the literature, which are then shipped to the locations where they will be distributed. I've been working with Hellenic Ministries in Athens, Greece since 2006 as part of their media team, working on all the graphics projects, all the printed material, and offering consultation on website design, doing photography, and some video as well, just covering every single aspect of this mission. The challenge I find is to continually be creative in all these areas, and God is faithful. He continually gives me ideas and new ways to communicate with the different people groups, understanding the different cultural backgrounds. And it's just really wonderful and such a privilege to be part of this amazing team at Hellenic Ministries and serving in this way. Thank you for supporting us and standing with us.
Thank you, Craig. Now, if you can join me with the opening prayer, let us pray. Loving God, you call us to prayer and offer yourself to all who seek your face. Pour out your Holy Spirit upon us today and deliver us from coldness of heart, a wandering mind, and wrongful desire. By the power of your living and active word, place within us a steadfast love and devotion, so that we may worship and serve you with all of our lives. Satisfy our longing with your presence, and through us bring glory to your name. We ask it through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
Okay, thank you. Morning, everybody. Morning, all of you out there and on the internets. Who we got out there today? Paul and Nancy Corder. So just a little bit of background for the Hellenic Ministries. Emily, right? Emily Argarides. And that is Nancy Cornish's niece, her sister Carolyn's daughter. Her sister lives in, help me out, little island, Cyprus, thank you. Well, not that little.
Emily looks a lot like Nancy.
Emily does look kind of like Nancy.
Yeah.
And they live in Athens, of course. And so she was speaking a little quickly there, but this is a wonderful ministry. Her husband is from either Iran, I think it's Iran. And so he speaks Farsi, for one thing. So they do a big outreach to Farsi-speaking, Arabic-speaking people in that area. So that's a pretty cool connection we have with them. So we're back in live service here, which means we will have glitches and problems, I don't doubt. We were late starting up today because of glitches. And, of course, Craig is relearning. But something went weird, too, so... and the sound has been funny. So I expect the sound is going to be a little funny. It seems okay in here today. I'm not sure how that translates online. They're saying it's good. Well, good. Eunice Pierce is thanking Melissa for one of her favorite songs that you just did. Eunice Pierce from Sudbury, that's Cheryl Russell's mom. Mm-hmm. We got Peggy, Cheryl, Lisa Harrison. Sorry for the delay, technology. It's Craig blaming technology correctly. Doug and Ruth Mitchell are out there. Leslie Banner, Jim and Donna Roberts, Jim and Marilyn Frost, Liz and Gary Matthews, Janice and Wayne Cox, Jan Tedford, Heidi and Blair Hampton, Ernie Collette and Linda. Oh, they're the Cornishes. Eunice, who else? Shirley Venner. Now, Shirley had a little stroke, but she seems to be doing really well. So congratulations. It's good to see you out there. Shirley? And Paul, at his house, they've got gathered Joy Cooper, Ernie, Linda Collette, Paul and Jen Burke, Alan and Sharon Galt, coming later, and Bonnie Kuman is in Virginia, and Lindsay from Wales.
Oh, wow.
So that's cool. I guess that's about it. So welcome, one and all. What am I doing? Okay, so we have, let's listen to some ministry of music from Melissa. And there's a video to play along with it, which is, we have no idea how the two might go together, but it'll be interesting to see. It's she's wearing the purple.
I'm all ready for Lent.
Thank you.
Ooh, thank you, Melissa. Perfectly timed, as usual.
Geez, you'd think we knew what we were doing.
That's amazing. It worked. So we're going to do Blessed Be Your Name. It's got a bit of a Lenten feel to it to me. It's got, you know, when I walk through the wilderness, that line in it. I'm going to try something different. I've got this extra mic here. I'm going to use it for the music, my music, instead of this head mic.
Try that. We've also got, can you still hear me?
Yep.
I know you can. I turned my head mic off.
So that's the difference in here. So that's back on again. I've also turned on this, there's a mic that kind of faces you guys, so they might actually be able to hear the congregation a bit today. So we'd like to hear any input, you know, say, oh yeah, we could hear the congregation today, maybe. We'll see how that works.
Not with your mask on.
Okay, let's give it a shot.
Oh, I gotta get my music up.
Blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise.
should hear all the sound turned in and up. Sounded pretty good in here. Mm-hmm. Hope it sounded okay. Oh, nice to be back live again. Okay, there's 13 here. Halliburton, there were seven. Well, eight. If we're going to count me here. There were eight at Lachlan. Counting me. So, what are we doing? Let's continue to worship the Lord as we present our offering. Now, I noticed that Dan and Roberta McComb came in today, so I thought I'd get them to do it. So, thanks, Dan. See you. He's so tall. So tall. Roberta, she's a little shorter. Thanks, guys. We give thee but thine own, why gift may be. All that we have is thine alone, I trust, O Lord, from thee. I forgot to turn that ear mic back on, that's right. Excuse me. Okay, prayer time. And big on all our hearts and minds is the story of Ukraine, the Russian invasion of Ukraine, and very upsetting. We shall pray about that. And any other prayer requests? Lynn. Okay. Okay. The poor people had to spend another night in the Dominican Republic. So Lynn's asking us for prayer for her daughter and her significant other, Paul, Colette and Paul. So we're going to pray for them. They got stranded in the Dominican Republic. They're having a hard time, I guess. No, the plane got struck by lightning. I don't know if they can hear you anywhere except here. I think that since Shirley has mentioned herself on the chat, I'm going to put Shirley on here today. Shirley, putting you on for healing. Yeah, she had a little stroke again. But she's home and she's using the computer and she's talking on the telephone, so she's bouncing back. She had one a few years ago too, so a mini stroke, yeah. So keep her in our prayers. All right. You guys remember the response? Okay. Okay. Can you move me so my face comes down to about there? So move the whole thing. Do you know how to do that? I'm a fussy guy. It's true. You have to do it on the left side and then, oh, look at that. Thank you. Perfect. Okay.
Did you grow?
I grew, yeah. Less walking around. I just laying there. Okay, let's pray. Lord, help us as we pray. Teach us to pray. We thank you that we can pray. We thank you that you have opened the doors of heaven by your grace and by your love and by your sacrifice of yourself once for all on the cross of Calvary. Lord, that we have access to our loving Father. And we come in time of need, Lord, and seek your grace and help. Lord, we continue to pray for our world as this pandemic hopefully comes to an end, that you would clear it from our world and bring us back to normal life. Lord, continue to protect those who have caught this virus. Continue to watch over those who are vulnerable and those who risk themselves by seeking to help others, especially those in the healthcare world. Lord, hear our prayer, and in your love, answer. And Lord, our hearts are heavy and concerned about the situation in Ukraine with Russia having invaded this land. Lord, we feel it's wrong, and we don't know what to pray for. We ask for an end to this hostility. We ask for an end to this war. We ask for peace, and we ask that you protect lives. Innocent lives are lost, and civilians are dying. Lord, we mourn, we lament, and we put it in your hands, and we pray for a swift end to this.
Lord, we pray for the Russian people as well, and for all those involved. Lord, we lift them all into your hands, and we ask it in Jesus' name. Lord, hear our prayer, and in your love, answer. We pray for Corey Richmond, for Sam, Paul Burke, for Baby Finn, Isabel Jolly, Bernice Ross, Linda Richardson, Walt Griffin Jr., Murray Misko, Victoria Ancaster, and Lisa Frost. Lord, hear our prayer. And in your love, answer. We remember Ray Limer, Rolly Faubert, Ushi Stouffer, Olive and Jim Waugh, Paul, David Paddock, Bernie and Linda Harper, Mary Sechrist, Gary Swaggerman, Kelsey Barnum, and John Payne. Lord, hear our prayer, and in your love, answer. We pray for Judy Davis, Ron Mark Jr., Mark and Teresa Beach, Carol Parnell, Kathy Binns, Amy Blanchard, Allie and Courtney, Caroline Hunter, Maureen Duquette, and Chris Rusk. Lord, hear our prayer, and in your love, answer. And we pray for John Bond and Yolande Dehan, Don and Karen Tran, Darko Knezovich, Steve Wigan, Colette and Paul in the Dominican Republic, Shirley Venner, and others that we bring to you now in the quiet of our hearts. Lord, hear our prayer, and in your love, answer, for we pray all of this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior and King. Amen. I'm going to call Lynn back up to read our scripture, to lead us in a prayer and lead our scripture.
Our scripture lesson this morning is found in Luke 4, verses 1 to 13. Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, left the Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness, where for 40 days he was tempted by the devil. He ate nothing during those days, and at the end of them he was hungry. The devil said to him, "If you are the Son of God, tell this stone to become bread." Jesus answered, "It is written, one does not live on bread alone." The devil led him up to a high place and showed him in an instant all the kingdoms of the world. And he said to him, "I will give you all their authority and splendor. It has been given to me, and I can give it to anyone I want to. If you worship me, it will be yours." Jesus answered, "It is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only." The devil led him to Jerusalem and had him stand on the highest point of the temple. "If you are the Son of God," he said, "throw yourself down from here, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you to guard you carefully. They will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone." Jesus answered, "It is written, do not put the Lord your God to the test." When the devil had finished all this tempting, he left him until an opportune time. The Lord bless this holy word.
Thanks, Lynn. Did we do the prayer? Well, anyway, see, glitches. Scripture has been read. Oh, so before we have music and stuff, we're going to hear from the Word of God, because it's communion. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for your Word. except you open our hearts and minds by your Spirit to the truth that sets us free, it doesn't happen. It doesn't make sense. It doesn't mean anything. Lord, so we pray that you would work in all of our lives by your Spirit and illuminate us, Lord, with the truth that sets us free. In Jesus' name, amen. Shortcuts. So some of you have the newer cars that have GPS. And how many have GPS? Well, I don't know, but you got GPS in the car. There you go. Pretty much all the standard features. But you got to be careful because GPSs will tell you how to, you know, sometimes take shortcuts that aren't really right. So, for instance, we know that it was a few years ago, there was a bus coming up from southern Ontario to take kids, campers, to Camp Wanakita. And the guy was using GPS, and he found out that there was a nice shortcut. You go through Inglesby, and you cut up the Tom Bolton Road, and then that would just turn naturally into the old Donald Road, and it would bring you out at Donald and zip down, you know, Koshlong Lake Road, and there you'd be at Camp Wanakita ahead of schedule, except the Tom Bolton Road and the old Donald Road do not actually meet up, except they sort of, there's a path on the GPS that shows you that, but there's a big beaver swaley bog right there in the middle, so kind of came to an abrupt halt. They had to apparently call the local school bus line to come and pick the kids up to take them off to Wanakita. So, yeah, that one didn't work out so great. So you got to be careful. And it's natural for us as human beings to want shortcuts. We like to make things quicker. We like to make things faster. We like to make things cheaper. We like to make, you know, all that kind of stuff. That's the mother of invention, almost. They say necessity is, but partly it's laziness and is the mother of invention. So, for instance, a wonderful invention that's quite handy is the microwave oven, right? I mean, it's a shortcut. It's a shortcut to heating up your coffee or your tea. Bing. A minute later, you don't have to heat up the kettle or, you know, put it on the stove. Bing. You're done. It's great. Don't try cooking a chicken. One. But they came out in the mid-70s, wherever it was becoming common in people's homes. And I was at Bible college in 1975, 76. And in January of 76, I was on a team, a singing team called an ensemble that went from church to church, and we billeted at people's houses every night for 3 weeks in Saskatchewan and Manitoba. It was super, super cold, is all I remember. It was like this winter here and out in the prairie, nice and cold. Anyway, we got to one lady's house, and she was serving us this dinner, and she got a brand new microwave, and it told her how to cook chicken. You gave a new idea to the idea of rubber chicken. It was not good. But you know, here's a basic everyday kind of shortcut that I've tried a few times. Like, you know, here's this bunch of stuff that I'm supposed to get at the grocery store. I'll just remember that. Why bother writing it down and taking all that time? Down to the grocery store, walk in the grocery store, blank. Ever had that experience? See, that's a shortcut that's not a good idea. And, you know, you just don't want to take the time to write stuff down. It seems like a bother. Why would you have to do that? You know. So today's scripture from Luke chapter 4 and the temptations of Jesus is essentially about Jesus being tempted to take what I'm going to call evil shortcuts. I mean, the goal that he's to arrive at, that, you know, is the same in either case. But the way that he's being tempted or you know, lured to the path that he's being lured to take in order to accomplish this end is evil. So first, though, why is it so important? And I believe in we need to keep reinforcing this in Christian minds. It's a doctrine. It's a basic, fundamental, foundational Christian teaching. Why was it so important that Jesus didn't give in to temptation? It's a big deal in the Bible. Matthew and Luke both have this long section of the temptations of Jesus and how he didn't give in. And Mark tells us about it. He doesn't go into the same kind of detail. It's mentioned elsewhere. So why is it so significant? So first of all, it's so important because Scripture seeks to establish him as the faultless, sinless sacrifice for our sins. If he was like the rest of us, if he's broken, if he's faulty, if he's sinful, you know, he can't die for the rest of us. He can't take our place. The whole gist of much of the Old Testament and the sacrificial system was to point ahead to the perfect sacrifice. And if you recall from your reading of the Law of Moses, you know, when they brought animals to be sacrificed in the temple, they were to be spotless and without blemish and no defect, right? And if they had some kind of genetic problem or some kind of blemish or discoloration, no, they couldn't be sacrificed. It was to be a spotless lamb. So when we get to the New Testament, I mean, John does not talk about the temptation so much in the Gospel of John, but he has John the Baptist introducing Jesus as the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Now, he can't do that if he himself is not pure. So again, it tells us that, you know, there was no sin found in him. There was no guile found on his lips. It's crucial. So that he could die for the rest of us, he needed to be the spotless, true, holy one who never sinned. It's crucial. And secondly, maybe not as important as that one, but very important. You and I struggle with temptation every single day. Often every day. And the secret to the Christian life is actually not that we know that this is wrong, so we're not going to do it, so we're going to use our mighty willpower, because that's not very, very reliable, is that we have Christ within us. The Spirit of Christ lives within us, and we know that he has the strength to withstand. And we get a lot of, and that's where we find, that's the source of our power. That's the source of our grace in order for us to withstand temptation in every single day. Yeah. So that's why it's so significant. So let's look at these evil shortcuts just briefly. So the first one is he's been out there for 40 days and 40 nights, which is, you know, the basis for the idea of Lent. Lent is a 40-day stretch. And the devil says, if you are the Son of God, tell this stone to become bread. You know? He tries to sow a doubt in Jesus' mind and try to make him prove himself. That's all what the if is all about. And you can hear an echo of his temptation of Eve and Adam back in the garden. Did God say? You know. He's always sowing doubt and sowing deception in people's hearts and minds. Let us remember the significance of this takes us back to the Exodus. So remember that this is 40 days and 40 nights. At the time of the Exodus, when the people of Israel wandered in the wilderness, was 40 years. So this is obviously an echo of what happened back in the day, and except it's 40 days rather than 40 years. Now, if you recall, what happened in the desert to the Israelites was they were tempted a lot, and pretty much most of the time they failed. I.e., remember when Moses goes up the mountain, gets the Ten Commandments and the commandments of God, and comes down the mountain, what happened? What's he find? The whole camp has built a golden calf to worship in place of their God. And they're dancing around and having a great old time. So right off the top, they're idolaters. I mean, they're adulterers, they're murderers. There's all kinds of weird stuff happens as they journey. But also, one of the things that happens is they get really hungry and they grumble about it a lot, right? And so God provides manna, he provides quail, they're thirsty, he tells Moses, tap this rock with your staff, and out comes water. So God is providing for their physical needs in the desert. So that's the background to this little temptation of Jesus. Hey, turn that stone into bread. Now, Jesus won't do that. And, I mean, he could have done that. And, the goal is right. He should get something to eat. And he will. One of the other Gospels says that after the 40 days was done, angels came and ministered to him. Doesn't say that in Luke, but it does say that one of the other Gospels. But here's the thing. If you go through the Gospels, you find that Jesus never once uses his power, which he has, just for himself, for his own purposes, you know, just to gratify his own needs. Never once. Never once. It's pretty amazing, really, when you stop to think about it. Because he does provide food. I mean, remember, he multiplies the loaves and fishes and feeds like thousands of people. And he does all kinds of miracles and he does all kinds of healing, even raises the dead. But it's for all these other people and all these other needs. It's all selfless love. And I wondered about this. I thought, well, hold it. Maybe this is an exception. Remember when he walked on the water? And was he just like, I'm going to do something cool. I'm going to walk on the water just for fun. But if you look at the, you follow the text, no, Jesus was needing to get from point A to point B to do his ministry, to love people. And so the short distance was, the guys had already gone off in the boat, and so he walks on the water. Plus, while he's walking on the water, the disciples see him, they're all freaked out, and they actually get a lesson in faith, right? Because faith is like walking on the water. You probably know that. Like, I don't know, but I'm going to try it. And, you know, it doesn't look like it can possibly work, but it does. And he calls Peter to come out. And Peter does for a little bit. And he says, why did you doubt, oh, you of so little faith? So it was a lesson in faith. So he never uses his power for himself. So his answer to this temptation to take this shortcut is about priorities. He says, it is written, one does not live on bread alone. And another one of the Gospels says, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. So that's actually the quote from Deuteronomy. So the priority is, you know, our priorities are not self-gratification, meeting our own physical needs. Those are important. But that's not the purpose of our lives. Our lives are for God. And we are fed inwardly and fed at our deepest part of us, in our spirits, by the word of God and by the truth of God and by the light of God. And that's what we need more than bread. And Jesus was simply putting forth that truth. So the second evil shortcut, the devil takes him up to a high place, showed him all in an instant all the kingdoms of the world, and said to him, I will give you all their authority and splendor, for it has been given to me, and I can give it to anyone I want to. So if you worship me, it will all be yours. It's interesting, really, you know. Satan claims, I mean, he's a liar, but he says, you know, it's been given to me, and I can give it to whomever I want. So just worship me, away we go. Now, you may say, well, this is ridiculous. Jesus didn't want... Well, Jesus, actually, his goal was to have a kingdom, right? The kingdom of God. He is to be the king of the kingdom of God. But his path is not to get the devil to hand him the power. His path is the path of suffering. His path is a long path of sorrow at the end, and of death, and of rejection. And he tells us, again in the Gospel of John, Jesus says, I, when I am lifted up, will draw all people to myself. All people! So that's how his kingdom is built. As he's lifted up on the cross, and the world looks at this suffering Savior, you know, that's how we're drawn to him. Not because he has great, you know, military might and political power. But, and the outcome of it is, he is to become and is the king of, according to the scriptures, the king of all kings and the lord of all lords. So that's a kingdom, right? And he's established it. It is yet to be seen, but it will be seen. It wasn't the way that he was being tempted to do it. So the goal was right, but the means is wrong. It's interesting, you know, when we think about this power that the devil seems to be able to hand out to people to some extent, when we think about the Russian situation and Mr. Putin and such, I can't help but connect the two somehow. And the desire, I mean, this is a temptation to have more power, right? To be a big ruler and, you know, to reform the USSR and all that baloney. And that's on a big scale, but all of us are tempted to use our position, use our power, use our influence for our own gain, our own personal private gain. And it might be just in the little club that we're in. It might be in our family, you know, wherever. But so Jesus dealt with that. And basically, his answer was, "I'm not worshiping you." It is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only. One focus. We don't worship the devil. We idolatry, which we're all tempted to, and we do fall into. Jesus did not fall into. The third evil shortcut is a weird one. As the devil takes him up on the peak of the temple and says, jump down. If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down. Because it is written. And he quotes Psalm 91, which we're going to sing at the end of the service today. It's right out of the scriptures. He will command his angels concerning you to guard you carefully. They will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone. So, you know, It's not exactly clear what the point of this was, but, you know, I've heard a good, I think it's a pretty decent interpretation of this, and it seems, it suits me, and it may be right. And the goal was to impress people to make them his followers. Now, the goal was right. Jesus was after followers, and he looked to have followers. I mean, he told people to follow me. I will make you fishers of people. You know, go and make disciples of all nations. So that's the goal, for sure. But the devil is telling him, do something impressive. Do something spectacular. Jump off the top of the temple, because the angels are going to catch you, and wow, will the people be impressed. And then everybody will follow you. So that's possibly what's going on here. You got, remember, so in the Jesus' day, Jerusalem was the big city, the temple was the big center of that city, and the peak of the temple was the center of the temple. And people were in the temple all the time. It was a common gathering place. So a lot of people would see this. It would be, you know, not just, it would be spectacular if he could just kind of Superman down, you know, and, you know, came to a nice soft landing, and people would say, wow, and they'd follow him. Interesting temptation, you know, to show off in order to get people impressed by you. And I think that's a very common temptation to humankind. And I think it's a common temptation for the church, and maybe it's part of our problem in the last bunch of years. As we've tried to make the church very, you know, relevant, and we very impressive sometimes with technology, sometimes with music, sometimes with flashy television shows and commercialization and stuff like that. Kind of, you know, where might we maybe be better drawing the line? Because it's not about impressing people with ourselves and with our capabilities, but telling people about Jesus. So I think that temptation is there. Jesus was not going to take that shortcut. He did come to gather followers, but he did it the long, loving way. Day by day, he trudged from village to village. He healed people. He taught the truth over and over again for years. And then he took the path to the cross. And his answer is, do not put the Lord, it is written, do not put the Lord your God to the test. God doesn't have to prove anything to anybody. And Jesus is like, I don't have to prove anything to anybody either. Okay. We're told in Hebrews, a book towards further on in the New Testament, it tells us that he was tempted in every way, just like we are, yet without sin. That's pretty amazing. So Jesus, whatever the kinds of temptations you and I face, whether they be greed, selfishness, lust, power abuse, violence, you name it, he was tempted toward those things. And we see the gist of it in these temptations, yet without sin, which is key. It's wonderful and amazing and important that we have such a rescuer, such a deliverer, such a savior, who was without fault and who could lay down his life for the rest of us. Every day, you and I are tempted, and we need his life within us and his spiritual power to resist and to stand in that day. Shall we pray? Lord Jesus, we thank you that you are our faultless Savior, that you took our place at Calvary. The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. We thank you, Lord, for laying down your life for each one of us, and that we are completely forgiven. And also, Lord, that you live in us as we walk by faith, and we have the power by your presence and by your Spirit to withstand in the day of battle, the day of temptation. So help us and strengthen us and be with us, Lord. And we pray it in your name, Jesus Christ, our King. Amen. Okay, we're going to sing The Church's One Foundation.
His new creation by water and the word.
Please have a seat. Perfect. In the name of Jesus Christ, I invite all who profess him as Lord and Savior and are seeking to follow in his way and to live in unity one with the other to come to his table with reverence, faith, and thanksgiving. Eat and drink for your strengthening so that you may grow in grace and be blessed with all spiritual blessings, remembering that we, although many, are one body in him. Would you join with me now in the Apostles' Creed together? I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. O God, who has called us from darkness into light, we remember your eternal promise to lead your people from the shadows of bondage to freedom's new dawning. We recall how in the fullness of time you gave us yourself in Christ Jesus, the light of the world. We thank you that by the power of your Holy Spirit we are born anew as children of light. We recall that on the eve of darkness, on the night he was betrayed, Jesus took bread, and when he had blessed it, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body broken for you." And after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the New Testament in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." We rejoice that on the day of resurrection, when he was at the table with two of the disciples, he took the bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to them. And their eyes were opened, and they recognized him. At the institution and upon the promise of our Lord Jesus Christ, we celebrate this joyous feast and join with the whole church throughout all the world in praising you. Together, by the presence of your Holy Spirit, may these gifts we offer be transformed from ordinary to holy things, so that as we eat and drink of them at this table, we may be fed and nourished with the body and blood of Christ, and so be united with him until we shall feast face to face at the glorious banquet table of heaven. The bread which we break is a means of sharing in the body of Christ. The cup of blessing we bless is a means of sharing in the blood of Christ. For every time we eat this bread and drink the cup, we proclaim the death of the Lord until he comes. Our Father who art in heaven, be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
The body of our Lord Jesus Christ, broken for you. the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ poured forth for you. We're going to use those little cups here in the church. So the top little thin one brings you to the wafer. Take it slowly. Kind of finding it.
You snap that little plastic thing.
Oh, yeah. Snap the little plastic corner. Did it. Getting it? Take, eat. This is the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, broken for you. Do this in remembrance of him. Get that second part peeled off. It's a little bit tricky. Take it slow. Take, drink. This cup is the New Testament in the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, shed for you for the remission of your sins. Do this in remembrance of him. May the body and the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ keep you unto eternal life. Amen. I invite you to share with me in our unison prayer. Next slide. I hope. Together. Holy Father, we rejoice that you have fed us at this table with the spiritual food of the body and blood of Christ and have united us in communion with your church on earth and in heaven. Grant us the abiding presence of your Holy Spirit. Enrich our faith. Nourish us through the means of grace. Strengthen our life together. Confirm us in our ministry and mission. And with glad and generous hearts, may we praise you and find favor with all people to the honor and glory of Jesus Christ. Amen. I'm going to try to play this hymn. We're going to sing On Eagle's Wings. I need a book. Uh-oh. Hold on a minute.
You need a book?
Yeah, I need a spare. Voices United. Oops. Forgot to do that. Has it got music in it? Yep, perfect.
Oh, has it got music?
Yeah, that'll work.
I make sure it's one that's going to stay open.
Yep, beautiful. Well, you're going to do the harmony, right, Ben? Yeah.
He doesn't even know what it is. They're very weird chords.
You dwell in the shelter of our God, abide in the shadow. Under God's wings, you're
Standing, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of His Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit rest and remain with each one of us, both now and always. Amen.
Oh, now in peace, never be afraid. God will go with you each hour of every day. Go now in faith, steadfast, strong, and true. Know God will guide you in all you do. Go now in love and show. Can see God will be there watching from above.